Good morning, good morning. Derek Watson, the angry dentist here. There's a lot of traffic about for this time in the morning. I'm a bit earlier than normal. There we go. It's a lovely sunny day. Tuesday the 21st of March. Bitcoin is $1,000 a coin ahead of a capacity upgrade. It's been a bit. The fact that the exchange traded fund was turned down has sort of hit confidence a bit, but we're expecting a capacity upgrade any day now, so it's just waiting, I think, to go up again. Bitcoin is digital gold. Well, I'm trying a new camera, by the way. Had a lot of trouble with sound synchronization. I was recording it on my Nexus 5X, which is, you know, I mean, it should be okay. I don't know why, if it's recording sound and recording video, it can't just do the same at the two at the same time, but apparently it can't. So anyway, we'll have to see. This is a Kodak. My wife bought this for me about 4 years ago, just before Kodak went bust. Kodak famously failed to adapt to digital photography, and then when they realised their mistake and that they were going to go bust, I think they started bringing out some stuff which was really, you know, quite exceptional. It was like, you know, it was double or quits for them at that point. So they brought out this tiny little camera, which was 1920 by 1080 at the time. The only problem with it is I can never be sure that it's actually pointing at me. I need to put a little makeup mirror or something on the front so that I can do my makeup. And also, just to check this pointing in the right direction, because at this sort of close distance, you know, I might just be getting my Adam's apple or my forehead or something. Anyway, looks roughly right. If this is useless, I won't broadcast it. Mind you, if I followed that rule, then I'd hardly broadcast anything. Yeah, so where was I? So yeah, so was Bitcoin is sort of digital gold. It's the digital gold 2.0. And Dash, which is the new digital cash, internet sort of money, is at, no, it's not 50, it's $100, isn't it? It's $100 now. So it's $100 for a Dash coin and $1,000 for a Bitcoin, which is quite easy to remember. And I've just picked up the Times and the Grawniad, and there are two articles about dentistry in the Times today. I know that because I read them this morning on my phone. And one is that the number of tooth extractions in the under fours has gone up, I think, by 25%. The other one is that in an international survey, I think it was the FBI, has done a survey and decided that British teeth are better than American teeth. And the Americans, of course, in particular, had a lot of mileage out of jokes about British teeth. And so really the boot's on the other foot. Not that it's going to stop them saying it, but it might stop them saying it, I don't know. But apparently they are they've got more. I think we've got on average 7 missing teeth and they've got on average 8 missing teeth or something. But anyway, we're ahead of them on quite a few measures. I mean, it's all appalling, well, I mean, it's all really appalling. The whole situation is, it's like, who's the appallingest? You know, they are. So, and they ask all sorts of stupid questions like, do you think it's a good idea to rinse out with water after you've eaten a meal, or should you brush immediately after a meal? And all sorts of stupid, I mean, there's no point rinsing out with water, ever, really. Let's just take a hypothetical example where it might be a good idea. Supposing you've just drunk a strong acid and you want to get rid of it as fast as possible because it's capable, the pH of this acid is capable of doing damage to your teeth. So then you might want to drink out of the water, but a rinse. But, you know, under what circumstances would you be doing that? You know, I mean, I suppose supposing you have just gargled with vinegar or something. Most people who drink acids, there are only three acids that damage teeth. There's citric acid, isn't there, which is basically people who drink like a litre of orange juice a day. There's carbonic acid, which is carbon dioxide dissolved in water, which you get in any sort of fizzy drink, whether it's from, and there, the old sparklets were the biggest offenders. They allowed you to carbonise your milk if you wanted to. And I never remember these three, the citric acid, carbonic acid, and acetic acid, which is in vinegar, which nobody really drinks. So, and you know, unless you're a big, you know, you had cider vinegar to your salad, or you're the sort of person that's got arthritis and you go on a cider vinegar and honey diet, and in which case there's no hope for you anyway, and telling you to rinse out the water is not really going to make much difference. So all this is all useless advice, you know. And it's the same with brushing your teeth. They say, should you brush your teeth immediately after you've eaten? Well, I mean, what's immediately? What is immediately? I mean, I would say immediately was, if you had like a knife, a fork, a spoon and a toothbrush set out on the table, then that is immediately. But otherwise, we're not immediately, you're talking like within about 15, 20 minutes, you know, after you've, after you've had your dinner, your dessert, your port and a cigar and a brandy, then go and brush your teeth. I mean, really, I'm not against brushing teeth, but I think just telling people to brush their teeth and not really showing them what they're trying to do when they brush, or telling them why they're supposed to be brushing, is ever really useful. And the sort of the theory behind this is that you've got bacteria on your teeth, and that they take the sugar in your food and they convert it into acid, and so the acid then starts to demineralize your enamel, and so somehow by magically brushing your teeth after you've eaten, you're going to interrupt this cycle. And of course you're not going to interrupt this cycle. I mean, either you're capable of brushing your teeth to the extent where you've got a very low bacterial count, in which case you're not really going to have this problem, or you've got plaque bacteria all over your teeth, and in which case you will have this problem, but you're obviously not capable of brushing your teeth well enough to do anything about it. So, well, what are you doing anyway? Do you think that do you know how fast bacteria work? I mean, really, they're like, we're talking seconds and minutes here. We're not talking, they don't hang about for 15 minutes, a couple of hours to do this. They're like, oh goody. They're like your average student in a one-bedroom flat. They've got no storage space. Something comes in, it's got to go out again pretty quick. So in comes the sugar, out goes the acid. And no amount of brushing or rinsing out is really going to do much about that. And it just fosters this stupid idea that brushing has got something to do with decay, which is, you know, started by Gibbs in SR in the 1950s to sell toothpaste, and built this association in the public's mind between toothpaste and brushing and how much decay you get. Whereas in fact tooth brushing is almost entirely related to gum disease and how much gum shrinkage you get in later life. And decay is totally down to how much sugar you consume. And don't forget the two tenets of dentistry, which are that everybody eats more sugar than they think, and nobody brushes their teeth as well as they think they do. So if we could solve those two problems, we'd solve all of the problems. Anyway, the children's thing is particularly sad, I think, because that is, you know, that's what the Americans call a cluster, you know what. That's a multi-agency failure, that. And there's no sign of anybody getting their act together in any sort of way that might fix this or stop it getting worse. And it all started with the changes to the National Health Service. The fact is that on a fee-for-item basis, we were paid to fill children's teeth on the same basis as adults. You were paid slightly less, which I think was stupid, because they're actually more difficult to do, at least properly. But I think you were paid less because the dental reference officers who came round and inspected the surgeries, you know, inspected your work, never really recalled children. They'd never recall a child to have a look at any work you've done on a child. So they sort of paid less, but then you were sort of allowed to get away with doing a bit less. You know, you could sort of clean a tooth out with an excavator of most of the decay, get a bit of glass ionoma on your thumb and press it in, and know that that would probably be all right until the deciduous tooth fell out. Whereas you couldn't do that with an adult, obviously, you know. And then in comes this stupid system whereby they're trying to sort of do a flat rate fee. And of course, when any employer or commissioner brings in a flat rate fee, what's the most natural thing for everybody in the system to do is to try and do as little as you can, isn't it, for the flat rate fee. You know, people are not stupid. They work within the system that they're given. That's why I think it's so important that we challenge whenever, you know, people like Professor Rebecca, what's her name, in Liverpool, start saying, oh, the dentists are gaming the system. When they use the word gaming, they mean it to mean cheating. The way that Edwina Curry used to use it. You know, I remember sitting next to Edwina Curry. We were watching someone give evidence to the House of Commons Health Select Committee. And she sort of, someone said, oh, you know, the dentists are doing this and they're doing that, and we didn't expect them to do it. You know, they're doing twice as much as this, or half as much as that as we thought they would. And she jumped up and down in her chair and clapped her hands and she said, oh, the dentists are cheating. Edwina Curry had an interest in dentistry because she introduced charges for checkups, if I remember correctly, which was a terrible thing to do. Terrible thing to do. I mean, introduce charges for fillings, introduce charges for crowns, do what you like. But really, introducing the charge for the checkup was the stupidest thing they could have done. And it was done deliberately to depress demand. And we knew, there was evidence at the time that it would depress demand. Where charges had been introduced in other areas of the health service, people were pretty well packed up going to do things. And we knew that what it would do is it would just deter people from going unless they had toothache. And with dentistry, that's the last thing you want to do, because it's, by the time you've got toothache, you've pretty well lost the tooth. She's like, oh yeah, she said, oh no, patients will welcome the opportunity to contribute towards the National Health Service, she said. Silly cow. And then she got co-opted, if I remember, this may be completely wrong, but I'm just doing it from memory, but I think she got co-opted onto the Patients Association by Harry Caton, who's the idiot who came up with the three bands. And so she sort of felt she had an interest in dentistry. Unfortunately, she went along to an LDC conference and got a right royal booing, and sort of lost interest in dentistry after that. You know, in the same way as the Home Secretary stopped going to the police conferences when the policemen started booing him. You start getting booed, and it's like. We have such a fantastic democracy, don't we? We have such a fantastic democracy that any democratic representative that appears in public without a bulletproof shield practically gets lynched. That's how much we love the people who lead us, you know? The poor old Her Majesty has to go around in a bulletproof car. We love her so much. And... and you know, you can't get in to see your constituency MP. They're cutting back on the constituency meetings because the constituents love them so much that they're in fear of their life. I mean, I know that there is a threat to the Queen from some lunatic. You know, there is, I'm sure. And I know there is a threat to constituency MPs from lunatic constituents. But there is a threat to me from lunatic patients. It's an equal threat. The threat that some lunatic, some mentally ill schizophrenic lunatic is going to just turn up with a bread knife and stab me because a bird told him to is equally real. And yet, do I get a bulletproof car? No. Do I get a bulletproof constituency office? No. Oh dear, the inequity of it all. The infamy, infamy. Yeah, so, children, I mean, what are you going to do? You know, if you're being paid a fixed rate and you want to cut back on something, what are you going to cut back on? You're going to cut back on the most defenceless, voiceless people without a vote. The people who are going to have no control over their dentistry. The children. The children's dentistry is what was the victim of the last contract. One of the many victims. And they... Oh, gosh. It's the surgery. They'll have to wait. So, yeah, so they had no voice, you know. Who speaks up for the children? You know, there's no children's representative. And the British Dental Association, sort of, they just turned the blind eye, you know. They just looked the other way. And you can't blame the dentists. You can't say they're gaming the system. That is absolutely not fair, you know. If I say to someone, look, I'm going to pay you £5 for widgets, and then they start making widgets, you can't say, what are you doing making widgets, you know? Every dentist is going to look at what's being asked of him, and he's going to do what's being asked of him. Well, the problem with the academics don't understand is they're not asking dentists to do the right things. Their system, they're saying, oh, well, we think it should work this way. Which is odd, because they're all about economics, they're all about rational actors. They're all about, you know, everybody's greedy and self-interested and acts in their own self-interest. Everybody's an actor, and all the actors in the system work in such a way to produce such and such an outcome. But it never does. They're always surprised at the way that it's gone wrong. It's like, oh, we didn't expect that, really? I mean, anyone who's done any dentistry, run a dental surgery, or been a dentist at any time in their life, in general practice, will tell you within 5 minutes how your bloody system's going to work. We told them before they brought in the UDAs. I personally sat down at meetings, there were five or six of us, Chris Audrey, who's the senior civil servant, now retired, who brought it in, Barry Cockcroft, the senior civil servant, stroke ex-GDC, GDSC member, British Dental Association advocate, now sort of semi-retired, gone on to work in the private sector for my dentists, God help them. And we said to them, you know, you've got problems with this UDA system. It's going to be unfair. It's going to be inequitable. You're going to find one dentist at one end of the high street is going to get paid X pound for the same work. Dentist at the other end of the high street is going to be paid Y pounds for. But, you know, the consultation period doesn't mean consultation. It might mean, it's just a ritual, you know. They just have to go through it. It just means just sitting down with the people who don't agree with you and then ignoring them. And of course, after a while, we realise that and don't want to waste your time doing it. And so what they do is they say, well, we've had a consultation period and nobody said anything really, so we're going to do it. So I'm like, well, yeah, fine. We're off. We're working in another system, thank you very much. You know, it's the best way to deal with the National Health Service is not to try and change it. It's just to work your way around it, you know. You come up across you're conquering a country and you want to come across, win the hearts and minds of the population. You come across a local baron who's a complete idiot, but he's in a castle and you can't siege the castle. So what you do, you just walk around it. But, no, I mean, in the old days, children did get fillings. Nowadays, they pretty much don't get anything. And of course, it's getting reflected in the number of children who are going to hospital for increasing number of general anaesthetics, the increasing number of extractions, just normal extractions. And we're going back, as we said we would. when UDAs were introduced. We're going back to the blood and acrylic days of 1948 National Health Service. And but then, you know, you could say, is that inevitable, you know, in a system where, with limited resources, is, you know, if all you can do is extractions and acrylic, then that's what you should do. But my argument is you could do so much more than that. If I had the budget, if I had the dental budget, I could do twice what they're doing with it. You know, it's the inefficiency, the incompetence, the stupidity of it all that gets me cross. And the Americans, of course, you know, their attitude is, they socialised medicine, for them, is like a real... That's like communism. Socialism is communism. Any sort of attempt to try and provide out of taxpayers' dollars anything that they think could be provided for in the free market is a complete anathema. And that's why they've got the system that they've got. That's why their teeth are worse than ours. Not because they're worse dentists or anything, but because they are... They've got a whole bunch of people who just can't go to the dentist because they can't afford it, unless they've got the healthcare through their work or something. So they end up with very few people who've got really excellent teeth, and then a ton of people who've got no dentist at all. So I'm making a right mess of reversing into this parking space. Okay, well, I hope this camera turns out okay. If you haven't been watching a video of my left ear, I'll probably just put the audio up with a picture of, I don't know, of a flower or something, if it's no good. So I'm off to work, and I'll talk to you tomorrow. Bye.